journey across the globe from Scotland to China with world's greatest train ride videos. Experience the breathtaking thrill and adventure of authentic train travel as you follow the tracks to unique history, fascinating people, and breathtaking scenery. All aboard!
Look, the proof is the discovery, this skull. It belongs to a being named Proconsul Africanus, ancestor of both man and the apes. He lived 18 million years ago. He left the forest and adapted to life in the savannas created by the Great Rift. Then the Leakeys unearthed the Australopithecus robustus from between 2 and 1.5 million years ago, most likely an herbivore. He probably ate fruit as well. The search intensified. The scientific community is astonished, for these finds challenge all the accepted theories. The movement picks up speed. Richard, the Leakey's son, follows in his parents' footsteps. He digs and discovers a Homo habilis, also 2 million years old. This was man. He shapes rudimentary tools out of stone. Then this Homo erectus, dating from 1 million years back. He has mastered fire. His tools are becoming more refined. He extends his territory, migrates out of Africa, and completely conquers the old world. Leakey's team even found this erectus skeleton practically intact. He lives in caves. His life expectancy is between 25 and 30 years. Then comes Homo sapiens and sapiens sapiens, 300,000 years ago. He spoke. He was as we are. They begin to bury their dead between 70 and 40,000 years ago. This is the beginning of social awareness. Africa and Kenya have let us discover ourselves. What voyage could be more stirring? Great Rift Valley. These high hills stop the clouds. Uplands, an elevation of 2,343 meters. The rainfall is abundant compared to the rest of the country. The region is rich in green vegetables. Wheat and potatoes grow well between elevations of 2 and 3,000 meters. Only 17% of the land is suitable for cultivation. The rest is mountain, savanna, and desert. A serious problem. The Kenyan trains are very comfortable. The service is impeccable. The disadvantage is their speed, or rather their slowness. They average only 50 kilometers per hour. And the delays, particularly when you leave the prestigious line of Mombasa, Nairobi. Daybreak on Lake Nakuru. Here we find the largest concentration of flamingos in the world. Some years up to 2 million, a third of the world's flamingo population. The water is warm and alkaline, favorable for the growth of tiny algae. The flamingos feed off the algae, and the algae feed off the flamingo droppings. A closed circuit. Perfect. A cob. Only the males have horns. White rhinoceros, very rare now. They were massacred for their horns. The Chinese believe that powdered rhino horn is an aphrodisiac, and they pay enormous sums for it. In all of Africa, there may be no more than 4,800, plus a few in Asia. As for the black rhino, it's even more dramatic. There was a world population of 65,000 in 1970 and 3,400 in 1991. They're given special protection in Kenya. Sometimes a particular rhino will even have his personal bodyguard, keeping constant watch. Warthog, in with the pelicans. It's a sort of boar. Fish, the tilapia, was introduced to keep the mosquito population down. The fish attracted flocks of pelicans to the point where they're pushing out the flamingos. It's the struggle for territory, that is to say, the struggle for life. The station of Nairobi, the capital. The railroad has been hard hit by competition from the buses, which can reach all the remote villages. This is an important factor. Nairobi is a mushroom town made up of an influx of country folk. Each inhabitant has family out in the country, and they visit them often. Inhabitants. The first thing to strike you is the street scene. Well kept. No sign of neglect. Everyone neatly dressed and considerate. Quite surprising, particularly for an African country. At an elevation of 1,700 meters, Nairobi has an excellent climate all year round. It's a city with many open spaces, full of trees and gardens. But just how and when was this modern city born? Not quite 100 years ago, on the chance decision of a railroad foreman. They had to set up a work camp out in a desert-like savanna. At first, it was an encampment of canvas tents for the supervisors and track layers. For it was not until the turn of the century that the English, who were well established on the coast of the Indian Ocean at Mombasa, really began a serious push into the interior of Kenya. A few adventurers, some merchants. The government in London saw that the railroad would reinforce its hold and ensure a profitable colonization of the peasants of the interior. The line was opened on March 30th, 1896. It reached Nairobi in May 1899, and very quickly the encampment became a city with its train station. The extension of the line continued. Laborers were brought in from India to accelerate the work. For the most part, it is descendants of these workers that make up the country's very successful community of merchants and storekeepers. The 10th of December, 1901, the railroad reaches Lake Victoria. Then a ferry links up with Uganda. The British Empire can flourish in East Africa. So the train is up and running. Sometimes it would even stumble and derail. The Prince of Wales, future Edward VIII, the king who abdicated for love, came to make a ceremonial visit. Kenya then enjoyed a very peaceful period. It was a sheltered universe. The British ruled with such an iron hand that even the independence movement that arose was quite moderate. Then in 1953, the bloody Mau Mau uprising. Reinforcements were sent in, as many as 50,000 troops, to suppress the revolt. December 1963, independence. The English leave. Jomo Kenyatta, charismatic leader, an obstinate man, and skilled politician, becomes president of a new country. He will have to make this patchwork of different tribes and ethnic groups into one nation. It's an enormous task. He died in 1978. Kenya is a republic. Leopard skins and powdered wigs. The English influence is still very present, from the government buildings, to the Londonian taxis, to the telephone booths. The Puritan frame of mind is still there, and the British self-control has hardly lost any of its rigidity. The streets aren't filled with gaiety, like so many other African cities. The students wear uniforms, just like the English. The main problem is the population explosion, which eats up any economic progress. The birth rate is 42 per thousand, a world record surpassing even the countries of South America. The population of Kenya doubles every 20 years. As a comparison, in France, it's every 230 years. Protestant preachers in the public square, again, an Anglo-Saxon tradition. Large Asian community, especially on the coast around Mombasa. They came via the aptly named Indian Ocean. With the Muslims, they make up only 11% of the population, but they practically run the economy. Christians make up 63% of the population, with a strong proportion of Catholics. A bit of an oddity in this country where almost everyone speaks English and Swahili, an Afro-Arabo-Indian dialect. Also penetrate the heart of Kenya through the memoirs of a woman who made this country known to the whole world through a love story, her own. The film, Out of Africa. This is the farm. The author and heroine of the story, Karen Blixen, a Danish baroness who lived here from 1913 to 1933. Here she is with her husband, Baron Bloch von Blixen-Finecke. He was a weak man, a woman chaser, and drinker. her office. This is where she conducted the business of running her coffee plantation, and not very well, it must be added. She painted the Kikuyus, the tribe that lived in that region. She had a great respect for them at a time when the colonists felt quite superior to the natives. It was in that time she fell in love with him, Dennis Finchhatton, a dilettante in business, white hunter, athlete, and playboy. All these traits made him most seductive during the wild years right after the First World War. They lived together in this house once she was separated from her husband, and as in the film, Dennis died in an airplane accident. He's buried at the top of this mountain. She returned to Denmark and became a writer. She died there in 1962. For her, writing was a way of gloriously reliving a life that was marked by one failure after another. The animals gather around the water holes. During the dry season, water is scarce in the savannah. We're in a national park. No construction, no farming. You can't live here. You can only pass through as a visitor. Here, the animals are in charge. There are 51 natural reserves in Kenya. This is the Tsavo, Nianayuki Lodge, a hotel. The powerful buffalo with their forehead like a battering ram. They live in herds. This little fellow timidly asks for a handout. Whole families live in the roof. Back home to the wife and kids, the baboons have a more of a hit and run style. A warthog. Family of cobs. At night, the animals leave their hiding places. It's a good time to approach them. Daybreak finds us in another reserve, Masai Mara. We're in Governor's Camp, a sort of lodge made up of tents. We're off for a balloon ride with the Mara Balloon Safari Company. There'll be a surprise for us when we land. To 15 passengers to a balloon and the flight captain.
Is this everybody's first flight?
Yep.
Balloon to Earth. We have liftoff.
Hey, we're the world. Right, boys and girls, this morning during the flight, I found a little bit about this area. A little bit about it.
Hot air takes us up, the wind takes us away. Giraffes and monkeys. The Mara River. Buffalo. Group of antelope making tracks. convoy of Land Rovers has been trailing us since we left. A herd of elephants. Passengers have to crouch down on landing to brace for the shock. A champagne breakfast right in the middle of the savannah, coming right up. They set up the tables right in front of the animals, who don't pay the slightest attention. One of the other balloons tipped over. A helping hand pulled them out. Well, this will make a good story when we get home. The elephants are keeping their distance, but just barely. We approach one another. The herds are mostly made up of females protecting their young. They carry for 22 months, and then they nurse the young for 2 to 3 years. Life expectancy, an average of 80 years. The elephant is both a creator and a destroyer. By his mass, he tramples everything that's on his path. But once he's passed through, the grass regrows, and new shoots are born to feed other herbivores, who would die of hunger otherwise. He has to take in 170 kilos of food a day. In fact, they eat round the clock. The surprising thing is that such a mass of flesh and bone is able to move so lightly and supply. How is it possible to kill this animal who can so enchant us with his grace and freedom? Heading back to the hotel. On the way, we'll stop to observe the different animals we chance upon. In Swahili, the local language, safari means journey, and in Africa, almost any journey is an adventure. Breakfast isn't over for everyone. For the staff, it's just starting. To finish it off, this game with the hawks. They're tossing them bits of leftovers. Antelope, topi, and zebra. They like to graze in each other's company, for it's a way of protecting themselves by giving the alarm. In the savanna, an animal on its own is an easy prey. A male topi is keeping a lookout for the herd, right nearby a lion. Films give a false idea of Africa. Most of the time they're all fury and bloodshed. It's not like that. The moments of drama are very rare. The big cats kill only for food, and the lion will eat only every 4 or 5 days. We have to stay in the car. As long as we do, there's no danger. The animals don't associate cars with enemies or predators. They're not afraid of them, therefore they don't attack. So in the car, we can get quite close. Out on foot, we'd be risking our lives. The female lions live together. They raise all the cubs in common. The males join the pride only to hunt and to mate. Herbivores do not all eat the same thing. It's a very elegant partition of the resources. The elephant eats everything: high grass, leaves, branches. They're not picky. The zebra feeds exclusively on grass. The topi and Thompson's gazelle prefer young shoots. So we can say that no two species eat out of the same plate. This is how they can all live side by side. No two zebra have exactly the same pattern of stripes, just as no two human beings have identical fingerprints. Giraffes eat mainly acacia. The thorns don't bother them. They chew them up with the rest, and they digest them without any problem. It's the only animal that has fully formed horns at birth. Here is an exceptional shot. It's rare to see a leopard. They're very timid. His spotted coat provides superb camouflage. He hunts at night, stalking his prey with extreme precaution. He's a solitary animal. Thompson's gazelles. a mother cheetah. This is the fastest of all the mammals, as swift as an arrow, 100 kilometers per hour, but only in a sprint. After 300 or 400 meters, he's winded and exhausted, has to stop to catch his breath. Right nearby, we have some drama. Two male impalas are facing off. The intruder came to challenge the old lord of the herd to try and take his place. After a few minutes of intimidation, the combat begins in earnest. Will the cheetah take advantage of the diversion to attack? All of a sudden, a surprising turn of events. The young bucks rush to defend the old male against the outsider. Do they prefer the rule that they know to a new one which could upset their habits? Or does each one hope that one day he will take over the herd? A mystery of animal awareness, the workings of their mind, the impulsions that motivate them. No, Mama Cheetah won't attack. She's ever watchful, like all wild animals. She seems worried, or in any case, on edge, for the air is charged with electricity, with menace. Governor's camp, we live in tents, one large room and a bathroom, but no electricity. Storm lamps for light. It's the easiest way of roughing it. In the reserve, there are traditional hotels as well. A little ways off, a waterhole. The hippos spend the whole day there, practically crowned with aquatic plants. Breakfast is served out under the trees. The buffet table is covered with mosquito netting to keep the insects off. Well, guess who's coming to breakfast? This elephant came straight off the savannah. There are no housebroken wild animals here. We scramble to get things out of his way because hurting any animal here is out of the question, much less shooting them. It's all fair game for him, even the sugar bowl. The napkin with the bread. The sugar bowl is not really edible. He spits it out, empty. A frying pan against an elephant. It's ridiculous, of course. But it's to frighten him, that's all. They also clap their hands to scare him. The elephant charges. General panic. And then he heads back to the savannah. Without a whole lot of fuss. And we head back to the safari. Maasai. They're the most spectacular people of Kenya. They're herdsmen, and their cattle are like their riches. They never sell their animals, never. They're like money jealously put aside in a sock. Their villages are protected by a high wall of thorn bushes to keep out the wild animals. Their diet consists mainly of milk and calves' blood, which they extract through the jugular vein. All the young men are members of the warrior caste. Their duty is to protect the tribe, especially during their frequent migrations to seek better pasture land. Flashy costumes, bright colors, beads, and trinkets, maybe, but very refined jewelry as well. We're on our way toward Mombasa on the Indian Ocean. The call for the very English ritual of 5 o'clock tea. The staff takes a break along with the chief conductor. The third-class bar car. a strolling vendor. His wares, toys, lingerie, combs, patchouli oil, shampoo, suspenders. Stop in a bush station. The kids run away giggling and squealing, as if the camera wanted to steal their gaiety. Sizzle plantations lined up like soldiers for inspection. Sizzle is a sort of cactus. The fiber in the palm leaves is very strong, and it is used in weaving basketwork. Its emblem is this triumphal archway in the shape of elephant tusks. The more down-to-earth symbol of this busy seaport is this incredible marketplace of second-hand clothes that will inundate all of East Africa. Mombasa is an island, and we're leaving it by ferry for a new adventure on the south coast. No, we're not in another country. Yes, we are still in Kenya. Here, we're flirting with the Polynesian dream. Tens of kilometers of beaches, unpolluted, practically deserted. The Indian Ocean is far away from everything. This hairdresser taking care of her clients reminds us that we are in Africa. The whole village is steeped in contented drowsiness. Graceful outriggers have taken the place of the massive Arab boats, which in the times of Sinbad the Sailor traded triumphantly all the way up to the Persian Gulf. Wild animals roaming free, all the way to these immaculate white sand beaches, we drift without leaving the dream. Yes, the Indian Ocean is indeed far from everything, and we wouldn't have it any other way.
The next World's Greatest Train Ride Video Adventure.